Freud and Tom Hanks as two L.A. police detectives in Dragnet. Adventures in Babysitting is about one wild night in the life of a teenage babysitter. And Martin Short becomes an unlikely hero in the science fiction comedy, Innerspace. It's all coming up next on Siskel and Ebert and the Movies.
Things that can fall into an industrial sausage press, not excluding rodent hairs and bug excrement.
I hate you, Strebeck.
Dan Aykroyd is Sergeant Joe Friday's nephew, Joe Friday, in Dragnet, the new comedy co-starring Tom Hanks as Friday's partner in the LAPD. And it's one of the new movies we'll be reviewing this week, plus our special tribute to the great Fred Astaire. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Dragnet is a very funny parody of the famous TV crime show that starred Jack Webb as the stern L.A. police detective who wanted just the facts, ma'am. Dan Aykroyd, the master impersonator from Saturday Night Live, gives a great performance as Joe Friday's act-alike, straight-arrow namesake nephew. When Aykroyd's on camera, the movie, frankly, doesn't need a story. He's got the voice, the clothes, and the manner of Jack Webb just right, as he prepares in this scene to arrest a TV evangelist.
Thank you.
Oh, I am sorry.
Hold it right there, Whirly. Police officer, you're under arrest.
I beg your pardon, what is this, some sort of a feeble joke?
No, it's a real knee slapper, friend, if you consider California Penal Code sections 484, 207A, 597, and 217, theft, kidnapping, cruelty to animals, and attempted murder something to laugh about.
I haven't the slightest idea of what you're talking about.
My partner and I witnessed that little torchlight picnic you threw last night, and we're going to put you where your kind always ends up, in a 7x7-foot gray-green metal cage on the 15th floor of some 100-year-old penitentiary with damp, stinking walls and a wooden plank for a bed.
I could listen to him talk like that the whole movie. I mean, I just wanted him to keep talking that way. It's great, and he does talk that way a lot. The story has two aspects. First, Friday is saddled with a hip assistant played by Tom Hanks, whose slovenly appearance really annoys this by-the-book detective.
I'm Pep Strebeck. I'm your new partner.
Not looking like that you aren't, mister.
Oh, really? What's that supposed to mean?
It means I don't care what undercover ruck you crawled out from, there's a dress code for detectives in robbery homicide. Section 3-605, 0.10, 0.20, 0.22, 0.24, 0.26, 0.50, 0.70, 0.80. It specifies clean shirt, short hair, tie, pressed trousers, sports jacket or suit, and leather shoes, preferably with a high shine on them.
That is wonderful. Together, the two join forces to battle one of the film's main villains, a porno magazine publisher, played delightfully by Dabney Coleman.
Could you please describe what's missing?
Well, how about the entire run? That's every single copy of our 25th anniversary double issue of Bait.
Bait?
Yeah, that's his skin magazine.
You see, the intelligent subscriber regards it as a politically oriented, socially impacting monthly. I'm not going to allow a gang of cement heads to intimidate me just because I refuse to publish their stupid manifesto.
How much do you figure a monthly run of your magazine is worth?
Well, let's just say it's more money than you'll ever see in your life. And I do that every month.
At least my money's clean.
Dabney Coleman, very funny there, too, with that list. That's a good touch. I enjoyed Dragnet, though, most of all because of Dan Aykroyd. It was very much like one of his classic Saturday Night Live impersonations, you know, Richard Nixon or talk show host Tom Snyder. Comedy bits that I wish back then had lasted a couple of hours. Well, now we've got a whole movie that does, and I think it's Dan Aykroyd that makes Dragnet one of the summer's great delights.
Well, Aykroyd is great in the movie, but I think you're being almost too hard on the others by omission. It's a good cast. There are a lot of good moments in this movie, a lot of great supporting performances, and some great scenes, including that pagan rite that they eavesdrop on with all the people dancing around with the thigh-high goat skins. That was a great thing.
That's funny, but I like the one where he meets the old lady who took with the foul mouth. Unbelievable.
Now, I have two criticisms of this movie based upon the style of the movie. First of all, Dragnet always had the alternating one-shot close-ups. Right. Where they, you know, where they have the staccato dialogue. What do you mean by that? You know what I mean. What's that? Oh, you know. They don't do it here. Right. They make the mistake of having them over-the-shoulder close-ups, misses the whole point. Seems like a small one, but it's a big one. And the second thing, Where do they get that crummy, crappy music in the beginning titles and at the end?
Disco
the disco
stuff.
Rap music video clone.
You know where that
junk.
Comes from? You know,
they should have used the Dragnet theme. At the end of the movie, I was hungering. I wanted to hear that da 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 da. I walked out of the theater singing it to myself because I wanted it so badly.
Well, the sad fact is that they didn't have enough confidence in the material.
No, they didn't.
That they had to try and hook kids in with some disco thing. They have got a great movie there. Dan Aykroyd, I'm going to go back to the main point, which is he is so great in this film. This is the kind of work that does not get Academy Award nominations. It should get one.
It is a good movie. They should go back and throw away all of that music that's going to be their hit single or something, put in the Dragnet theme. It needs it. It would have been that little. It might seem like a small thing. It would have helped the movie.
It's a legitimate complaint, but not on a positive note, which is nominate Aykroyd for an Oscar.
Okay, positive note. Here we go. Positive note. Now, next movie. Our next movie is named Adventures in Babysitting, and it's a Chicago teenager movie. That's and Chicago movies are always about teenagers. Nobody
risky
above
business.
The age of 19 lives in Chicago.
Ferris Bueller.
We commute from out of town, I guess. That's a cross between two other Chicago teenager movies, Risky Business and Ferris Bueller's Day Off. This movie could also be called Ferris Bueller's Sister's Day, Night Off. It stars Elizabeth Shue as a babysitter whose best friend calls from the downtown bus station with a desperate cry for help. She needs somebody to come and pick her up.
Can you pick me up?
No, Brenda, I'm babysitting.
Chris, I can't call anybody else. My dad doesn't know. He'd kill me if he found out. Chris, I'm begging you. It's really scary here. I've just seen three people shoot up, a bald Chinese lady with no pants on, and there's this old guy outside who wants his bedroom flippers.
Get out of my house!
Going against her better judgment, she packs up the three kids she's responsible for and takes them into the city where their car is stolen with them inside of it.
Did you steal all of these cars?
Yeah, it gets me some good money.
Isn't it kind of dangerous?
They escape from the car thieves by walking across a beam, a dangerous way out of the chop shop, but their escape route leads them on stage at a Chicago blues bar.
Sir, we didn't mean to interrupt your little concert here. If you don't mind, we'd just like to let ourselves off.
Nobody
the stage.
Gets out of this place without singing the blues.
What?
Nobody leaves this place without singing the blues.
You want me to sing?
There are a lot of neat adventures in this movie and a lot of good energy from the actors, and everything revolves around Elizabeth Shue. You might remember her from The Karate Kid as Ralph Macchio's girlfriend. She gives a strong and likable performance in this movie, and the movie has one absolutely great scene in that blues bar when she steps up to the mic. He says, "Nobody leaves without singing the blues." So she steps up to the mic and she says, "I'm a babysitter," and the band goes, da-da-da-da. That was a good scene, and that turns into her personal blues song. I like that moment, but I don't know. This movie as a whole never quite caught hold for me. It kept drifting back and forth between realism and absolute unbelievable fantasy, and I was never sure they were visiting the real Chicago or a movie Chicago. Ferris Bueller, to me, which is a parallel story, was more believable. I don't think they were ever really sure in this movie whether it was a fantasy or not. It was a close call. A lot of good stuff in this movie, still a thumbs down.
And a close call for me, but a thumbs up, because I thought there were enough funny scenes that I was taken aback by it. At first, I thought this was going to be just another wild night out, and I don't think it was just another wild out. I think this Elizabeth Shue caught my fancy. Mm-hmm. And when she is in the blues bar, suddenly the whole picture comes alive, and from then on, they had me. I was going with them. I wasn't sure what they were going to do next. They really run all over the town. I think that, and if you're going to compare Chicago teenage adventure movies, that in the narrow category, I think that this is much more entertaining than Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
There was one thing in this movie, one area they got into, and then they didn't get into it, and that is a lot of the adventures that these white suburban kids have are with black Southsiders in Chicago. In a blues bar, in a chop shop, there's a thief, there's a car thief. Later on, there's a hitman.
Yes.
And so I thought, Well, are they going to get into some sort of a, these kids are entering into a different world here and they're meeting different mm-hmm. people? But no, the black characters all just stayed in their roles. One was a thief and one was a blues singer. We didn't get the interaction that I would have enjoyed.
Okay, well, we got interaction, which is frankly more than sometimes happens in the city.
That's true. Yeah.
And the other thing is, there was one kid who is pivotal. We're not sure which way he's going to go. Mm-hmm. And so I think there was some racial balance in the film. I thought some of the portrayal was a little dangerous, but every time you bring up race in the movies, you're not so sure if they're doing it right. On balance, I like the picture.
And the blues bar scene that we're talking about, now that all by itself was a fabulous scene. Coming up next, Innerspace, the wild story of what happens when a scientific experiment miniaturizes a test pilot and then he winds up inside the body of a mild-mannered checkout clerk.
Somebody help me! I'm possessed!
Our next film is one very ambitious comedy called Innerspace, which combines elements of the picture of The Fly, an experiment gone wrong, with another movie called Fantastic Voyage. Remember that one? It starred Raquel Welch, miniaturized, taking a trip through a person's bloodstream. Strange film. In Innerspace, however, Dennis Quaid stars as a test pilot who volunteers for a radical experiment. He's going to be reduced in size and injected into a rabbit. Unfortunately, after he winds up in the syringe, he's injected into the bloodstream of a mild-mannered grocery clerk, played by Saturday Night Live's manic Martin Short, who can't believe someone is inside him.
You don't work at the lab, do you?
Lab? No, I work at Safeway.
And you don't know anything about the experiment?
What experiment?
Oh, God. The miniaturization experiment.
No.
All right, Jack. My name is Lieutenant Tuck Pendleton. I've been miniaturized. I was supposed to be injected into the body of a laboratory rabbit, and somehow I got inside you instead.
What do you mean, somehow? How?
All I know is I was inside a syringe, and now I'm inside you.
High-tech thieves want to steal the microchip process that has reduced Dennis Quaid, but in a quiet moment, Quaid wants to know more about the man he's inside.
Is that you?
Yeah, it's me.
Look at you.
Yeah, look at me. Go to the mirror. Come on. How's this?
A little too close, Jack.
Too close? What's this? This is good?
You know what? We're gonna need a lot more help.
They do really sort of like each other. And there's also a nice love story involving Meg Ryan as Quaid's girlfriend, who grows eventually to like the nerd who encapsulates her boyfriend. Innerspace is very ambitious. You can see all the things that are going on in a love story, the two guys, the plot of the high-tech thieves. So much is going on at times, it actually wore me out with some of its special effects and all the story twists and turns. And yet, I admired the various performances. I was amazed by some of the humor and the effects going on inside Martin Short's body. Short is really all funny by himself. He doesn't need that many special effects. So I basically liked Innerspace. I just wish it had been edited a little tighter. I wanted the story not to belabor itself.
I also felt the story ran on just a little bit too long. It could have been tightened up a lot. But boy, there is a lot in this movie.
Yes.
And the special effects were interesting because they used, it looked to me like, actual photography of inside real human bodies. Those scenes where he's being dragged down into the valve of the heart there, it was almost like Michael DeBakey should have been the cinematographer for that one. And the whole plot is fun because Martin Short is fun as the guy on the outside. Dennis Quaid is charming. He's got a great personality, but he sits in the capsule the whole time. Short, who really didn't realize his potential in Three Amigos, is really good this time. This is the first movie where I think he could be a movie star.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you wait when there's a big talent on a show like Saturday Night Live, you wait for the movie. Eddie Murphy got lucky, hit it right away with 48 Hours. Now Martin Short has his picture, and it's called Innerspace. It's that good. When we come back, our special tribute to the most graceful man who ever appeared on a movie screen, the late Fred Astaire.
Hollywood legends is that when Fred Astaire had his first screen test, a talent scout filed this report. Can't act, can't sing, balding, can dance a little. Somehow, now that's just probably apocryphal. It's just a little too good to be true. But the guy was right about one thing. Fred Astaire could dance a little. The man who died this week at 88 was already a vaudeville star when he was 6 years old, but it wasn't until he teamed up with Ginger Rogers in this classic scene stealer from the 1933 movie Flying Down to Rio that one thing became perfectly clear. Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers and the movies were made for each other. Nobody had ever seen dancing quite like this before. Again in the gay divorcee, made a year later in 1934, and using dance as a daring symbol here of seduction.
Cigarette?
And the cigarette there was just kind of a subtle reminder to audiences of that period that essentially, symbolically, they've just made love.
Right.
One of the things Fred Astaire always insisted on was doing his dance numbers with the camera showing the full length of his body and with as few cuts as possible so that he could preserve the idea of the whole dance experience. In fact, Astaire and Rogers managed to make 6 films in a row in the 30s in which there was only one single dance shot that didn't show their full length figures.
And of course, the reason he wanted that full body shot is that he wanted the musical numbers to tell the full story of the bodies and not this flash dance stuff that we get now, or just action. He wanted the bodies to tell the story. Fred Astaire also had a career in Technicolor films. I prefer the black and white pictures myself, but he is joyful dancing with Judy Garland in Easter Parade, making Garland seem like a pretty good hoofer herself, even though their steps don't match. Fred Astaire was very smart about his career. He knew when to stop dancing. On film, his last dance musical was the often charming Finian's Rainbow, made in 1968. Fred Astaire was 69 when he filmed the scene. I said before that Fred Astaire knew when to stop dancing. Well, he was 69 years old when he knew he should stop dancing. Not bad. Fred Astaire did leave his reputation intact, his deserved reputation as the greatest dancer in movie history.
When we come back, we're going to choose each of our favorite scenes from the films of Fred Astaire.
Maybe by the time I'm 50, I'll get up and do a nifty.
Pick our favorite Fred Astaire dance numbers, and mine comes from Swing Time with Ginger Rogers. It's the pick yourself up and dance number, where first Astaire pretends to be a bad dancer who wants to take a lesson from instructor Ginger Rogers. Then, once he's in her arms, he turns on his legs and he sweeps her from one side of the screen to the other. The way they walk off together, that is one of the great moments in movie history. It's so subtle, but it's so beautiful.
Every time I've seen this movie with an audience, when they walk out that door, there's a cheer. It's a great moment. Now for my favorite scene, or one of my favorite scenes anyway, because I love all those great black and white films from the 30s too, especially Swing Time,
yeah. The
one you picked, and the scene where he dances with 3 copies of his own silhouette. But I thought I'd pick a scene from almost the last dance movie that Astaire made, Silk Stockings, filmed in 1957 when he was 58 years old. He only had one more, Finian's Rainbow, to go after this. The movie stars Astaire as a movie producer based in Paris, and Sitcherise is a very stern and strict Russian bureaucrat who finds herself falling in love with this imperialist American.
Thank you.
And once again there, you get to see the whole figure. And actually, I talked to Astaire in 1969, and he was kind of angry with Francis Coppola, who directed Finian's Rainbow, because sometimes the camera would cut off his feet or cut him off at the knees, and he was against that. In fact, 1982, I talked to Ginger Rogers at the Montreal Film Festival, and she was talking about Flashdance and the Travolta picture Staying Alive, you know, and she said, the young people today, they think they can dance with their faces.
Right, they wouldn't. They don't have to show the whole body. Right. Well, they couldn't dance like Fred Astaire. That's one of the reasons why they cut their bodies off. Mm-hmm. Well, now to recap our reactions to the movies on this show. We both got big laughs from Dan Aykroyd as Detective Joe Friday in Dragnet. Two thumbs up. We had a slight split on Adventures in Babysitting. Elizabeth Shue made me follow her anywhere. Roger wasn't always sure where she or the movie was going. One thumb up, one down. And we both liked the ambitious, sometimes too ambitious, science fiction comedy Innerspace, starring Martin Short in a terrific role. Two thumbs up. So the one we really like, Dragnet with Dan Aykroyd.
Dragnet and Innerspace and Rent and Astaire and Rogers Video.
Maybe two or three.
Okay. That's it for this week. Next week we'll be back with another one of our Buried Treasures programs. Overlook movies on video that we think you might enjoy. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
Nestle Crunch. It's creamy milk chocolate and crispy crunchies. Chocolate is scrunchious when it crunches. That's why you'll love Nestle Crunch. Bacos adds that delicious bacony crunch to all your salads. Bacos. Riuniti Natural Peach. It's bursting with the luscious taste of fresh peach. Riuniti Natural Peach. PTS Turbo 1000, the lean, mean workout machine with contoured cushion seat and computer readouts. It makes you want to get on and play. PTS Turbo 1000 from Protex Sports.